So everyone's talking about habits. There are books, there are articles, there are stuff in social media. Apparently there are these habit hacks that can make you more productive, more focused, more effective, get you less distracted, get you eating healthy, exercising, stop smoking, all that kind of good stuff. All you gotta do is form a habit. But is it that simple? Or are we way overemphasizing on one side of the equation and completely not talking about the other side of the equation that's equally important and critical for success? Let's find out. So habits are basically actions that were once decisions that you made, but eventually have become automatic and subconscious due to multiple repetitions. In his book, Power of Habit, Charles Duhigg talks about the habit loop, which basically consists of a cue, a craving, a routine, and a reward. The cue could be something as simple as you driving home on a nice sunny day. The craving is willingness to have a nice cold beer outside. The routine is you drinking those beers. And the reward is intoxication. You repeat this enough and it becomes a habit. BJ Fogg, in his book Tiny Habits, calls this motivation, ability, and prompts, while James Clear calls it triggers and actions. They're basically the same thing. You get the point. So do habits work? A short answer, yes, they do. In fact, they're incredibly powerful. There are many well-researched and documented examples of habits doing their magic. Take Eugene Polly's case, for example, which is quite popular in medical literature. So this guy basically suffered brain damage because he was in a coma for 10 days due to encephalitis. He woke up, lost all his memory. He doesn't remember anything. He would do odd things like wake up, cook himself breakfast, forget to eat it, then take a nap, then wake up again, then make breakfast again, then forget to eat it. And he'd keep repeating this until someone stopped it. But there's something quite interesting that happened with Eugene. One of the important parts of his daily routine was to take a walk around the block with his wife Beverly. And she was told to constantly monitor her husband because if he ever got lost, he would never be able to find his way back. However, they later discovered that on multiple occasions, Eugene had taken a walk by himself and managed to get home. But how? The answer is repetition. With enough repetitions, there is a certain thing called chunking that happens where our brain converts a series of conscious actions into automatic routine. So yes, Eugene could not remember or hold any new memory, but he didn't have to because the walk had somehow become automatic. Our brains can only remember around 7 pieces of information with our conscious mind. So it's constantly looking to optimize any repetitive tasks into automatic subconscious behaviors. And it's quite good at that. So if you repeat an action often enough, it will become automatic and therefore effortless. This is called the Polly principle. The habit loop in Charles Duhigg's book takes advantage of this exact same principle. So how do we create habits? We take familiar cues and familiar rewards, but replace the existing routines with new ones. Repeat that enough times and our brain makes an automatic association with the new behavior. For example, every time something triggers your craving for beer, without thinking, just go do something else. Something else that you enjoy. Say cooking. Every time the craving happens, you cook something for yourself. It's inconvenient, I know, but it's required for repetition. And the reward is the satisfaction of making that meal and also the delicious treat that you get to eat. Repeat this enough times and it becomes subconscious. The same thing that used to trigger your craving for beer will suddenly start triggering a certain desire to cook food. It works like magic and I've experienced it myself. See, I used to be a social smoker. My cue was someone going out for a smoke, a friend or a colleague. My craving was obviously wanting to smoke. My routine was, hey, I'll follow you, I'll join you. And my reward was obviously the nicotine hit. I've always wanted to quit, but I struggled. So I used this habit hack. Every time I got the craving to go out and smoke with someone, I'd actually pull out my phone and text myself. The text would read, I'm in a position where I can go out and smoke, but I choose not to. That was my new routine. Seeing those messages to myself go from one message to 2 to 5 to 8 to 20 gave me a sense of accomplishment. And that was my reward. I've not smoked for a few years now. This sounds crazy, but even today when I'm hanging out with someone and if they go out for a smoke, I instinctively pull out my phone. This is just how good our brains are at rewiring behaviors through enough repetitions. I always knew that smoking was bad for me, but just knowing whether something is right or wrong isn't enough to invoke action. BJ Fogg calls this the information action fallacy. The idea that if you give people the right information, they will change their behavior and attitude is wrong. It's flawed because most of our behaviors are subconscious and automatic. And to modify those, we need to use existing cues and rewards and rewire them to new routines. This is how Kellogg's use sugar as a craving to brainwash everyone into thinking that breakfast is the most important meal of the day and that their cereal was the solution. This is how rats figure out how to navigate complex mazes to find treats. This is how cats figure out how to pull levers to get out of dark boxes. It's all automatic. It's all habit. By now, you're probably thinking, wait, didn't you say that we're overemphasizing habits and that there's something else we need to consider that's also critical? Yes, you're correct. And this is the point where I stop singing songs about how awesome habits are and actually tell you when they fail. I think habit hacks and habit loops are great tools for replacing routines that are subconscious and automatic, and those that don't require much effort or deliberation on your part. Or when a routine is simple, the routine you're trying to build doesn't require any specific structure, or there's no resistance against building it. Where habits fall apart is when the routine you're trying to create faces a strong resistance from yourself or requires a defined structure to achieve. One of the most common examples people give about habits is the routine of exercise. You come home from work, you see your workout clothes, that's the cue. You either go work out or you skip your workout, that's the routine or the habit. And then your reward is maybe a snack or watching TV later or whatever that is. See, that never worked for me because I despised working out. I would go to great lengths just to avoid exercising. So if a snack were to be a reward, it had to be so big or so unhealthy that it would outweigh the benefits of exercising itself. BJ Fogg, the author of Tiny Habits, suggests a solution for this. What he did was every time he went to the bathroom and flushed, he'd have to do 2 push-ups. And over time, he'd end up doing almost 40 or 50 push-ups throughout the day. And this sounds really good in theory, but it's not that effective in practice. Even though he did 50 push-ups throughout the day, what was the reason behind exercising? To get stronger, to get fitter, to get healthier? And it's well researched that to get any of those benefits, you have to create what is called a progressive overload on your system. And you can do that essentially by increasing resistance, either doing more reps during the same period of time, adding more weights, or creating an isometric hold. None of those are achieved by doing 2 push-ups at one time because there's simply not enough progressive overload to create any of those benefits. So you end up skipping exercise completely, or you make it so simple and effortless that you get negligible benefits from it. This is where goals come in. Remember the other side of the equation I was talking about? Putting in 110% in the gym, preparing for a marathon, becoming a better musician, studying for an exam. These things require deliberate and structured approach. They need the extra push of a challenge, some motivation, external forces that automatic subconscious habits simply cannot provide. For example, James Clear in Atomic Habits says that if you need to get better at playing guitar, just place the guitar where you can see it actively and then retrain your brain and connect it to some other cue or a trigger. Sure, that works for making you play more guitar, but it's a horrible and ineffective way of getting better at playing music. To get better at guitar, your practice needs to be structured and deliberate. That's why these kind of things are a great fit to become goals, not habits. While habits are built on top of familiar cues, rewards, and subconscious routines, goals require solid objectives, structure, commitment, and most importantly, a concrete deadline. You can't reach your goal by subconsciously repeating things. Zig Ziglar, the author of the book Goals, introduces us to the concept of activity versus accomplishment, where he warns us of mindlessly doing some activity just because it's a habit. Jean-Henri Fabre, a French naturalist, did a series of experiments with processionary caterpillars to illustrate this concept. They are called processionary caterpillars because they tend to follow each other in procession. He lined them up around a flower pot, one after the other, forming a never-ending circle. And then he placed some pine needles in the center, which is the primary food of these caterpillars. They started going around and around until they eventually dropped dead of starvation, even though their favorite food was just 6 inches away. Hopefully you're seeing where I'm going. Benjamin Hardy, the author of Willpower Does Not Work, outlines 4 key steps to creating concrete goals. 1, knowing what you want and why you want it. 2, creating forcing functions. 3, outsourcing your behavior expectations to your advantage. And 4, designing your own environment. Let's say you've always wanted to run regularly, but you're not a fan of it. You can barely run a mile. You take the plunge and register for a marathon that's coming up shortly with the goal of completing it. Here's how you'd set up that goal. First, ask yourself why you want to run the marathon. Maybe you just want to check it off your bucket list. Maybe it's a challenge. Maybe your significant other is running the same marathon and you want to be a part of it. Maybe it's for a cause, like against cancer. Second, create forcing functions that will push you towards the goal. According to Hardy, the most powerful forcing functions are high investment, social pressure, high consequence for poor performance, high difficulty, and novelty. Third, rather than assuming how you would perform or how you would do, outsource that and let other people build expectations for you. If you make things public, people will either say, hey, you'll do it, I trust you. Or people will be, hey, you can't even run a mile, maybe you should consider this next year. Or everything in between. Let that drive you and work for you. This is called the Rosenthal effect, where others' expectations of a target person affects the target person's performance. Fourth and finally, you need to design your own environment. And this, I think, is where habits and goals come together and create perfect synergy. Charles Duhigg talks about keystone habit, small changes or habits people introduce into their lives that carry over and unintentionally make a great impact in every aspect of their lives. Exercising, food journaling, family relationships, meditation, positive thinking, keeping a consistent routine, these are all keystone habits that together can create an environment that helps you achieve your goals. So then, the million-dollar question, which one is it? Habits or goals? Which one do you need to focus on? And hopefully by now, the answer is glaringly obvious to you. Both. You need to be able to build good habits and focus at concrete goals. One relies on repetitions and automatic behavior, while the other funnels in external pressure and expectations to fuel you. And hopefully this video has given you some insight into which activity is a better fit for a habit versus what is a better candidate for a goal. And this differs by each individual. So you can decide now how you want to look at your aspirations. Do you want to run every day or do you want to run a marathon in 3 months? Do you want to play guitar every day or do you want to play a song at your friend's wedding? Do you want to do push-ups every time you flush or do you want to participate in a Spartan race that's happening in 6 months? Choose whatever works for you. In the end, what we are looking to do is use the best tools to become a better version of ourselves.